Good evening to all our participants and a warm welcome to our respected speaker, Dr. Shweta, and our principal madam, Professor Shuli Shorkar. Today, the Women's Studies Center, Lady Prebon College, has organized a national webinar to mark the occasion of the International Women's Day 2021 and celebrate the 11th Foundation Day of the Women's Studies Center, Lady Prebon College. Emancipation and empowerment through education has always been the primary vision of Lady Prebon College, and keeping this tradition intact, the Women's Studies Center of the college was formally inaugurated on 8th of March 2010. Ever since its inception, the Women's Studies Center has actively organized seminars and workshops, published books and journals with the aim to assimilate and disseminate knowledge with the sole mission to create awareness and to sensitize society towards the urgent need for a more equal world. Today's program is another such effort. To inaugurate the program now, I would humbly request Madam Principal Professor Shuli Shorkar to deliver the welcome address. Madam, please.
Thank you, Mahua. Respected Madam Speaker, Professor Shweta, respected the coordinators of the Women's Studies Center of Lady Prebon College, Dr. Porna Ghosh and Dr. Shanghita Ghosh, and also Srimati Mohua Rai, respected guests and dignitaries, my esteemed colleagues, and our beloved students. A very good afternoon to you all. It's a wonderful occasion when the Women's Studies Center of Lady Prebon College has organized a webinar to celebrate the International Women's Day and also the completion of 11 full years of the Women's Studies Center of the college. And the webinar is being started now. It is quite interesting to note that as a result of poor health, education, and occupation among our women, the position of women inside the family is significantly weak or dormant. Women are neither allowed nor prepared to take any major decision independently within the family. All major decisions taken by the male members of the family are sort of imposed on them. And this leads to a kind of political apathy among women. A number of studies on political participation have revealed that women in general are less participative in politics than men, because women are less educated and hence less aware of the political issues. The question is, what is the remedy? In this context, we must acknowledge the role played by the 73rd Constitutional Amendment Act, which is really praiseworthy, by which a compulsory one-third reservation of seats for our rural women was introduced since 1992 in the Indian Panchayati Raj bodies at all three levels of district, block, and village. But critics still raise the questions like, is women's political participation only through reservation or quota really meaningful to the concerned women? That is, are these women who participate in politics as a result of reservation, are they free to take any decision independently without being manipulated by the male members of the panchayats or by the male members of their families? In other words, can such kind of women's political participation really lead to women's empowerment. We are, in this context, eager to know how empowerment can be redefined in the 21st century, or to be more specific, in a period when we are almost on the verge of completion of the first quarter of the 21st century. This becomes a pertinent question more so in the context of the COVID-19 pandemic. It really becomes necessary for us to know whether wives can feel free when their husbands spend most of the time at home doing work from home. What kind of freedom is being enjoyed by them in seeing their favorite TV series or in chatting with their friends and relatives? If wives are also working from home, how the single or the only computer of the household is being shared between the husband and the wife? Is there still any discrimination, though in a very subtle form, in prioritizing boys' online education over girls' online education within the same family or in general? How performance of domestic chores was shared between women and men in the family during the period of total lockdown, when domestic helps were also not allowed to enter the households? These and a number of many other empowerment related questions, or I should say gender disparity related questions, naturally come to our minds, and answers to such questions probably can attach a new dimension to the connotation of empowerment as such. I'm not going to linger my speech anymore. We are all eagerly waiting to hear from our respected speaker. And I'm pretty certain that after her talk is over, a number of questions will be raised from the members of our audience, and a number of their probable answers too are to be provided by our resource person today. And at the end of the webinar, I'm pretty certain that everybody present in the webinar will feel more and more enlightened, more and more enriched. I wish today's program a grand success. Thank you.
Thank you, Madam Principal, for such an insightful and thought-provoking talk. And moving ahead now, I would now request Madam Principal, Professor Shuli Sarkar, and our chief editors of the newsletter of Women's Studies Center, Dr. Porna Ghosh, Associate Professor of English, and Dr. Shongita Ghosh, Assistant Professor of Bengali, to kindly release the 11th volume of our newsletter for the year 2020. Thank you, Madam Principal. Thank you, Porna Di. Thank you, Shongita Di. Thanks a lot. Thank you. Our speaker for today's national webinar is Dr. Shweta. She will be speaking on redefining women's empowerment. Dr. Shweta is an assistant professor in the Department of Sociology and one of the first batch of faculty members of the Mahatma Gandhi Central University, Bihar. She did her PhD from the Department of Anthropology, University of Delhi, on her thesis titled Riverfronts of Benares, an Anthropological Study. Her work primarily reflects on the spatio-temporal dimensions of the Ghats of Benares. Dr. Shweta has authored research papers and published in journals. She has presented papers in numerous international seminars in anthropology and had been invited as a participant in a conference in Bhutan. Apart from her academic endeavors, she is an active theater practitioner ever since her student days at Miranda House and has been a part of Anukriti, the reputed theater group of Miranda House. She has won many awards in this sphere, not only in the capacity of an actor, but as a director as well. Andher Nagri is one of her much acclaimed plays. Shweta ma'am, we are honored to have you here with us today. And without much delay, over to you, Shweta ma'am. It's all yours now. Shweta ma'am, unmute yourself, please.
Thank you so much, Mahua ma'am. First of all, I would like to thank Honorable Principal Ma'am Siuli Sarkar, and then without whose efforts it would not have been possible. Mahua Ma'am, thank you so much. I chose a topic, Redefining Women Empowerment, because I always believe that instead of giving huge theories, which are the meta-narratives and grand narratives, which are unable to describe what a woman like you and me and those 109 people who have connected to us today on an occasion which is known as International Women's Day. What does it mean? How does it resonate with our everyday life is more important than understanding the grand theory. Today, while I'm getting this opportunity to talk about redefining women empowerment, I also understand the history of the college where I am presenting my lecture today. I believe that the college was instituted in somewhere around 1931. And with a faith and belief that the education for women is really important for the development of the society. So when the legacy and belief in education of women for the development of society ran in 1931 in the country which was still not the part of India, Lady Brabourne College, colleges like Miranda House, colleges like LSR, Lady Shriram College, are the flag bearers of what actually means women empowerment. I hope we all understand the fact that initially when Lady Brabourne College, and I was really impressed that I'm getting an opportunity to speak.
Ma'am,
in
the
an
college was founded in the year 1939, so it's 82 year old now.
See, this is what, thank you so much, ma'am. Thank you with the data. I was confused. And see, while I read it on Wikipedia, I was amazed by the fact that there were reservations made specially for Muslim women. And then education for women was way ahead in Bengal. And that is why we always fear of Bengali women. There is this cultural connotation in many states. You know why? I am a part of state like Uttar Pradesh and Bihar. I have friends from Maharashtra. I have friends from Odisha. I have friends from Himachal. And in their everyday life, when they have to ask a woman to stop, they said, do not talk like a Bengali woman. Do Bengali aurton ki tarah baat mat karo. And now I realize in the span of say 10 years of my education, and I'm too young to speak on it, but I realized the fact that the women in Bengal, present day Bengal, were much more liberated, educated, and they understood the fact that what education means and what speaking for themselves mean. And Lady Brabourne College is the flag bearer of that. So I'm really thankful to all you guys who
Thank
are today.
Thank you so much, ma'am.
Thank you, ma'am. So, before I begin my lecture, I would like to present few data with you. It might sound little boring, but then we have to realize that while we are sitting here cherishing the moments of our life under this comfortable stay, which we know as home, there is a report by Rizvi and Roth from the year 2010, which talks about what has been the status of women statistically in our country. Now, this report says that 37.8% of the government schools, the Dalit women have to sit separately and eat separately. Now, 27.8% of the villages in our country have police station where the Dalit women cannot go and register their complaints because their entry is restricted. Now, 23.5% of the villages there, they do not have any mail delivery system, the postcard, the letter delivery system. Now, you will be aghast by looking at the fact that out of 1,08,025 cases of kidnapping and abduction registered in the year 2019, the number of females were 84,922. Another thing, out of 4,05,861 cases of crime against women during 2019, which is an increase in 7.3% from 2018. The increase is tremendous. A number of women have been Dalit, SCs. Now, 45,935 cases were registered for committing crime against SC women. This is again a 7.3 rise from the case registered during 2018, out of which 3,486 cases were of rape. Another thing here is that out of 8,257 cases against the ST women, which is a rise in 26.5% from the year 2018, there were cases of 1,110 rapes and 880 cases on the intent to outrage the modesty of women. Now, what do these statistics mean? They are just numbers, they are just percentages. But beyond that, we have to realize that in an year, there were more than 4 lakh cases of abduction, of rape. And in public life, the women are threatened. Now, when we try to understand the concept of empowerment, it is very important to understand that what the definition of women is, how the gender of women has been constructed over the period of time. You all might have read a plethora of readings like Gemmerman or like Simone de Beauvoir. And also, not to forget how Ambedkar has talked about women, how Phule has talked about women. And we have a literature on gender, which is a long deliberation on the question of the nature and the genesis of women's oppression and subjugation. In all the texts, we talk about it. Now, the question is historical. It is not new. It has been written in 1920s, in 1970s, the women movement of 1930s, the neo-women movement, the feminist movement of 1960s. And then the question is coming to the root concept of the sexual role, which is primarily assigned to the woman. The term man and the woman are served in contrast, in opposition to each other. What makes me a woman is all the roles which are associated to my sex, to my gender, though they both are different things. But biology has drawn upon culture and culture has drawn upon biology. In your everyday life, you will see that women are explicitly devalued as per the roles, as per their task, as per their products and their social milieu. A very significant example is the domestic chores in which the women are involved. What is the price? What is the productive value in the market of the domestic chores in which the women are involved? The maternal obligation is domesticated. It is naturalized. It is as if it comes naturally to the women. It is the responsibility of the women to have maternal instincts, to care for the society, to care for the children, and to care for the people around her. And in case you defy it, you are not a woman enough. You do not fall into the category of being a woman. Now, implicitly, when you see these are symbolic devices. They are social structural arrangements which are ingrained in our role, in our status. What is the role, the position that we occupy as a mother, as a sister, as a teacher, everywhere, as the status that we have, like the principal of the college, the teachers, the faculties of the college, which are excluding women from the participation in the highest powers of the society. Women are always attached with activities of lower order of existence. There is a lot of taboo. I'm not talking about the explicit cases where you have a span of 6 years or 6 hours or 8 hours or 10 hours and where you are controlling their resources. But your everyday life, when you get back home, I'm talking about those activities where there is a sense of lower order of status. The taboos, for example, attached to the childbirth. In our culture, a woman should not be approached after the childbirth for at least 7 days. Menstruation, in our culture, a woman who is menstruating should not be allowed to go into the kitchen, and we do not go into the temple. We consider it a sin. They are just a few of the taboos that I'm talking about. And it is so naturalized. We do not question it. Why? Because in the name of lot of belief and faith, we have made it a sandwich practice, which instills in us that, yes, it is righteous of us to have faith in it, to not question it, to not question that why our body has been attached to the defilement, to the impurity, or to the concept of chastity, that how you should organize your body. And to name a few, I'll also here emphasize on the fact that the caste system has given another kind of problematic domain to the gender, to the women. It gives an order, a pattern in organizing our womanhood. In South Asian context, when we look at what women are, when we look at how gender is organized, it is heavily structured by power. It is subjective. The women face everyday forms of resistance which are hidden and veiled. The moment you step out of your home, time becomes meaningful. Sunset becomes meaningful. The meaning of dark is different for you than it is for men. A lot of feminist scholars have started looking at this subversive constructs of self-perception. What does it mean to be a woman? Their moral discourse. What does it mean to be an upright woman? And their everyday resistance. How are we coping up with such kind of practices which make us realize that, yes, I am a woman. Now, you will find it hard to believe that there are scholars like Appadurai who portray the very fact that, you know, what makes a woman, being a woman is a mode of thought, which is governed by a set of rules, regulations, and laws, and they are brought to the social order by giving it a treatment as if it is a compulsory medicine. See, you have to be a good woman and this is the medicine for you. Now, it will be really wrong on my part if I do not talk about and highlight the fact that there is this female passivity that we all are facing. And the representation of this female passivity is played by the double role in creating morally just society, which dates back to the colonial rules. Partha Chatterjee, 1989, highlights that apart from the failure of the Mughal emperor to rule and integrate the Indian nation, there was another reason that British conquest was possible. He highlights that the political condition of India was not the only reason that the Britishers were able to rule us. He talks about how the British conquest as a state of anarchy, lawlessness, was the very much reason of the degenerate and barbaric social customs of the Indian people. He talks about the protection of weak and the passive Hindu women which becomes a strategy for the colonial domination. Now, embodying the colonial hyper-masculinity, because the Britishers believe that the Indian men are not strong enough. The Britishers saw India unfit to rule itself because the representation of the women and their silent submissiveness, which was dictated by the religious tradition, was overtly available to them through literature, through the studies that they had conducted. In case I am given an opportunity and I am able to ask you that, how do you define a female? We always associate the definition of female with the virtue one has. Now, what are those virtues? Is it strength? Anybody? Is it valor? Is it intelligence? Is it smartness? Is it business acumen? No. As far as I remember, as far as I have read, and as far as I have seen in our everyday language, and language is very important because it constructs the meaning and the faith and the belief that we have put into a system, women have always been associated with. A female's virtue is of sacrifice, of purity, of humility and silent suffering, which is brought forward as a national cause, as a cause which will keep the family united, as a cause which will keep the society going. I don't know how many of you will be able to relate to this fact that in a normal Indian household, we often evoke the allegories of Sita, Lakshmi, Savitri to rest the roles of women within the traditional limit. It was in 18th century that a text named Stri Dharma Paddhati was written. And do you know why was it written? It was written as a treatise to entail the inherent nature of women, which is grounded on the Dharma Shastra. How should a woman be? It was a lens which was used to understand the role of the women in history. And a very strong mode of pavitrita, purity, is attached to the body of the women. Now, when I talk about purity, which is attached to the body of the women, why is this purity a concept so apart that it is only falling in the domain of the women and not the men? How have women been reduced to the flag bearers of purity, of the name of the family? And this notion, which is strongly attached to the body of the women, is ingrained in our caste system as well. There is this strange internalization of being docile, of being passive, of not asking questions, of internalizing this form of patriarchy, because of an anticipation that yes, someday we will be able to inherit this authority from the women who are senior to us. A very, very, very significant, a very strong example that I myself felt after getting married. You know, in our Brahminical rituals, we have Kanyadan. So what happens? The girls are portrayed as silent shadows and they are given away in the marriage into the household, which is headed by the husband's father. Now, there is this female passivity. There is this feminine passivity which has been arranged historically. I did not question it. I believe that this is how it is arranged. And I'm telling you the fact that being a woman who strongly feels for the women, I did not question it, that I am being given to another family in a kanyadan, and I have been raised and brought up in the family. My parents took a huge effort to educate me. And here, the subordination was wrapped and concealed under the terms of sanskar, under the terms of accha, bhadra, sanskari, where not only the men, but also the senior women of the family were involved. So there was a break from where I am separated from my very own kins. And it is a classic example of endogamy, a classic characteristic of caste, a classic characteristic of how women is organized. In last few years, I have always believed that the body of the women is always in the public domain. We are never able to decide for ourselves. We are never able to speak for ourselves. We are never able to think for ourselves. The culture that I teach in my classroom means three things: thinking, doing, and believing. Now, when I see at the body of the women and the women per se, it appears as if the women are out of the culture. It is the men who have designed the culture for us. And in case we question it, we are tagged along the negative lines. And when I'm telling you that the women, body of the women is always in the public discourse, in the public domain, try to understand that the day you are born till the day you die, it is the decisions of the men imposed on you for all the important things in whichsoever religion you fall, in whichsoever caste you fall, in all the important structural institutions. So right now, when we are celebrating International Women's Day, the UN men have decided that what should be the topic of this year? It should be women in leadership. Since 1930s, the women movement started, the feminist movement started. A lot was written about what are the pain of the women. Ambedkar talked about it. He talked about how patriarchy has always oppressed the women and how there is this inherent authority in the patriarchy, in the societal system, and which you feel on the road, which you feel in the toilets, in the public toilets. When you go to the market, how many number of public toilets have you seen? I have been to Calcutta, I have been to Bada Bazaar, and I'm unable to locate the number of public toilets for women as compared to the number of public toilets it is for the men. So from here itself, from the problem which is so basic as having access to hygienic practices, that the problem of women begin. Now, we have always seen men and women as fundamental and enduring, and the differences between men and women are supported by the division of labor. There are certain tasks that the women can do, there are certain tasks that the men can do, but there is this strange sense of prestige attached to the labor that the men are able to do. But why is it not that the same prestige is attached to the labor that the women are putting in? Do we all have a consent to the fact that women are the barriers, the role models for the procreation and the survival of the species? In Indian context, we are able to locate and give a context to gender in a specific site, at a specific location, which in Western context is binary. Either it is white or it is black. Either it is rich or it is poor. But in Indian context, when we talk about gender and when we are trying to define what women is, there is a spectrum, there is an array of concept which is possible. We do not talk about women as women. We talk about Dalit women, we talk about tribal women, We talk about women who are poor, who are rich, who are fat, who are thin, who are not able to give birth to the child, who are divorced, whose husband left them. So there is this spectrum, there is this range in which we have tried to define women in our Indian everyday context. Now, this is beyond the biological core, and in some instances, quite independent of it. It would be appropriate to say that gender encompasses, in Indian context, a range of other practices, assumptions, and expectations about what it means to be a male and what it means to be a female. I would like to cite here R.W. Cornell, who has described gender as a process, social embodiment, or a body reflexive practice. Now, there is this loop, there is this circuit linking the bodily practices that are directed by the social structure. Gender is intimately connected with the process and the structures within it, and through which the actors, the actions themselves, and their social actions as embodied beings are made appropriate. Now, this notion of social embodiment is very important. The notion of social embodiment is a postmodernist concept, and it is useful because it gives a lot of stress and importance to the social context in which the gender is defined, because the gender involves both body and the biology. Now, I would like to present here what I have prepared for you. Just a second. Is it visible, ma'am?
Yes, yes, Shweta ma'am, it is visible. You just need to maximize the screen once again.
Yes.
Okay, ma'am, I'm doing it.
It's yes. Visible, but in a small version.
I've expanded the screen. Is it visible now?
Yeah, yes, yes, yes.
Okay, thank you, ma'am. Thank you so much. Now, when I say that, are they all same? There are three different pictures that I have put. This is the picture of gender equality. This is the picture of gender status. And this is the picture today that we are talking about, women empowerment. Often, the term women empowerment has been confused with gender equality. Now, the term women empowerment has been propounded by a lot of international organizations. It has been advertised by a lot of international organizations. But there is a strange fact that the World Bank addresses when it talks about women empowerment. Now, it says that the women empowerment is not just about empowering the women with the economic status. It talks about the 66% of world's working hour, which has been contributed by the women. But the women are able to gain only 10% of the world income. Do you all understand the fact that the women produce 50% of the world's food, yet they possess only 1% of its wealth? Out of 900 million adults worldwide, there are 2/3 of the women who are not able to read. Imagine there are 900 million adults in this world, and 2/3 of 900 million are the women who are not able to read. Now, in 21st century, empowerment has become a new democratic styled discourse, which is used by a lot of political parties, a lot of institutions and international organizations. And believe me, today on the occasion of Women's Day, my university, all the centrally funded universities, institutions and organizations must be celebrating Women's Day remotely. A lot of people have written about, and there are so many writings which have cast the framework of empowerment, but empowerment seems to have a little more body to it than responsibility delegated from above. The word empower, I'm going back into the terminology of it, is an old Oxford English, as per the old Oxford English Dictionary in 1971, says it is a verb to invest legally or formally with power or authority. So the empower word has the terminology power, which has been defined brilliantly by a lot of scholars in sociology, in political science, Foucault, Bourdieu. So as per the old Oxford English Dictionary, it means to authorize or license. So when I am talking about the sense of authorization or license, there is a meaning to gain power over something. Does empowerment for women means gaining power over something? No, it doesn't. It becomes obsolete. Now the women empowerment in 19th century has become capaciously opaque. It has a functional ambiguity to it. We are not able to comprehend what actually women empowerment is. When we talk about women empowerment, we have to understand the fact that there is this notion of power which is created and is vested in the discourse of truth. Now, what is truth? The truth is how we are living our everyday life. In 1990s, people started becoming vocal and they started raising their voice against the injustice that the women were facing. And it was in 1990s that the term women empowerment became popular. The empowerment of women has been highly acknowledged, but from where we all are positioned, all the hundred of participants who have joined together, each one of us should reflect that today empowerment is multi-layered, multi-dimensional concept. As per the World Bank, Empowerment and Poverty Reduction, a source book, they have defined empowerment in its broadest sense as the expansion of freedom of choice and action. But this is also applicable to the other groups who have been excluded, the subaltern groups, the people who are poverty ridden, the people who have no access to resources. But are the women in a position to instill the concept of empowerment as it has been defined by the World Bank? Is it about the expansion of freedom of the choice and the action of the women? There are important points to understand here that when I'm talking about women, we are not just one group among the various disempowered subset of the society. We all belong to the cross-cutting category of individuals. Some of us come from a family where our parents are educated enough to send us to schools and colleges and educate us and let us live the life that we believe in. Some of us come from the family which is Dalit, from the family who is not having enough of the resources to feed the children of the house. Now, I have just presented on the screen that how fragmented the image, the identity of the women is. And the more fragmented our identity is, the narrative of each and every woman changes. Now, many of the people question that when it was 1930s and 1970s, which was leading the feminist movement, why did the Indian women do not have a univocal voice, a voice of unison, where each and every woman would have stood together and said that, see, this is the problem. Why did not we do that? We could not do it because the problem of the women who belong to the different sections of the cultural society was different. The problem of Dalit women were different. You would not believe to this fact that in Uttarakhand, there is a village named Chunni village, where to, even today, the Dalit women are not allowed to take water from the well. It is believed that in case they come in contact with water, the water will become impure. A lot of women in our country have to walk miles and miles to take the water pot, bring it back on their head in the bamboos. In Northeast, you will see the women toiling in the fields, working hard. I did a 14 days field work in Nagaland, in the village named Longwa, where I saw that it was the household responsibility of every woman to organize food, agricultural produce, clothing, and means of education for the child. But who was the head of the family? The men. And in the 21st century, the problem of women is not just about belonging to a particular caste or religion. It is also about body shaming. You are too fat. You are too skinny. You are too bony. For what purposes? Primarily marriage, then society. During COVID, there was this 4 to 5 months of lockdown, and I would believe that 1 month of stagnation in the kind of work we all were doing by not going outside but managing at home. So what were women doing? They were balancing between the household chores as well as working from home. Now you see how different women belonging to the different sections of the society are placed at a location which is household interfamilial domain. And that is the central location of women's disempowerment in the way that it has disadvantaged us as a group. How many of you believe that the government is responsible for what the women are going through? How many of you believe that the law is responsible for what the women are going through? Or the institutional structures are responsible for what the women are going through? Because when you try to break it down, understand root cause of the disempowerment of the women, you will realize that the empowerment of the women does not require an institutional transformation. It does not require law. It does not require an external agency to enforce upon us and to make us believe that what our strength and power is. All it requires is a systemic transformation, not just of institutions, but of all the system which is supporting the patriarchal structure. Now, when we talk about the concept of women empowerment, often we are disillusioned by the fact that the women empowerment is all about giving an economic strength to the women. It is about making the women self-reliant and independent rights to make choices and control over the resources are not just rooted in the economic strength. Do you think, I'm giving a very short, small example, that the women in Odisha, in the rural Odisha, they have economic strength. They earn through the agricultural produce. They are earning through the Odisha government initiatives of technological kiosks that they have created. But do you know who has the control over the earning that they have? It is the household head. So, and yes, the household head is the man of the family. There is this specific relation between the class, culture, caste, which all create barrier and it layers to the identity of the women. As the famous quote goes, one is not born woman, by Simone de Beauvoir. What do you understand by it? What makes a woman then? It is this social system, the system which has created the definition of being a woman that makes us a woman. The economic strength may enable us to reach a point where we can take charge of creating things for ourselves, but we are not able to take charge of what we want to do. We still seek permission. It was in 2008 when I went to my college in Miranda House. And this is a reflexive account, and I believe that every woman should have a reflexive account of what he or what she has been through, so that the he of the society understand that our problems are not macro structural problems. Our problems are at micro level. So see, you see, 12 years of English education, it was in only in 2008 that I come to know that there is something named International Women's Day. We celebrate womanhood. But today, when I am into my job and my occupation, where I'm teaching my students, I realize that empowerment is not what it actually means. It has always bothered me. Why? Because it gives me a fuzzy feeling. The term empower means to give authority or power to somebody. So who is going to give us the authority? Who is going to give us the power? The issue, therefore, is resting in the concept of to give. To empower the women means that the power must come from the external source. Now, who is that external source? By whom will that power come? By whom will that lesson come to me that, yes, I am empowered enough to make the decisions and to choose rationally? The whom is the entity which already exists. It puts us to a reference point of the giver. And here the giver is patriarchy. When we talk about empowerment today, it is about removing the effects of unjust inequality. It is a process of change towards greater equality, greater participation of women. I have just put a photograph of a lot of women who are participating in a rally, and this is what the process is. It is not just about the one day celebration where we gather and we realize and we talk about how the women empowerment should be achieved and how important it is for the sustainable goals of the society. You know, if every nation is able to empower their women, we will have 15% rise in our GDP. It means that by increasing the female empowerment, we can boost our GDP to over $6 trillion. $6 trillion is a huge number. So it is the process of the everyday life where we have a realization that we can put our feet forward and work together for the betterment of our sisters in the world. When I talk about the process, it is about the greater equality or the greater freedom of choice of action. The second is the agency, the concept of agency. Women as the agent of change, where the women empowerment talks about how my ability to make strategic life choices in a context where this ability was previously denied to me is given a recognition. It talks about the agency at an institutional level where my participation and social inclusion is cared for. I'm not excluded from making a decision because I am a woman or because My left cerebral is not able to talk logic. This is how psychology has defined women to an extent, that women are less rational, they are less logical, they are overtly emotional. So my emotion underplays the fact or downplays the fact that I am able to take the rightest decision. At the micro level, it is about believing in ourselves. It is about saying that, yes, I can do it. I do not need the sanction from the society that should I do it or not? Should I go for the further studies or not? Or is it compulsory for me to adhere to the rules and regulations and the traditions that the society has created in the name of goodness, in the name of sense of security? But, you know, there is another problem when I talk about agency. So when I talk about agency as an essence of women empowerment, does it imply that the improvement of the women's status can be brought only by the women? No, I'm not talking about it. Agency as the essence of women empowerment doesn't imply that all the improvement in the position of the women must be brought through the action of the women alone. The policies, both legal and political, the reforms to give women greater access to resources has to be devised. And how are we going to devise it? How are we going to make a policy where the women are given equal opportunity as men? Why am I talking about equal opportunity as men? Because in India, only 23% of the women are internet users. 1/3 of the women employment is in agriculture. And 73% of the women who are working in private sector believe that there is a lack of opportunity for them as compared to the male counterpart, and that is why they prefer leaving their job. In all this time, the term power has been negated, but the term empowerment tediously talks about power. Power is a disputed concept. It means different things for different people. So therefore, the meaning of empowerment that I am talking about is different from the meaning of empowerment a man who is in a socially privileged position is owning a position of political hierarchical status will talk about. The conventional meaning of empowerment has put a strong emphasis on access of political structure in decision making. It has put a strong emphasis on the economic sphere, on the access to the income and to the market. But for us, the women who reside in our homes, who move out only as the clock permits us, the interpretation of empowerment is more than simply opening up the access to decision making. It is more about the processes that have led us to perceive as enabled and entitled. Am I enabled and entitled to occupy this decision-making space? It is not about power over something. It is about power to the women, power coming from the woman or the women. A very good example of this is that even if you have institutionalized a structure which gives, like ma'am said, honorable principal has talked about, giving reservation to the women in the political system, making the classroom teaching accessible to the girl students today, making the public spaces accessible to the women today. But how fruitful is it if a woman does not feel entitled to occupy this space? If she feels that she is not good enough, she is a lesser being, she is not at par with the men folk, And when I'm talking about men folk, I am not taking away the credits from the LGBTQI plus community. I'm not talking about them. They are totally into the different kind of debate, and we all can talk about it some other day. But right now it is about the men and the women. It is about the heteronormative trap that we all have fallen into. That we have institutionalized the system that many a times the women do not feel that they are empowered enough, or they are even in a status, in a position enough to do something good, to be the part of that reservation where that the government has provided them. And that is why they become the puppets in the hand of the family head. While I was preparing for this lecture, one of the definitions really resonated with what I believed. It was of Mac Witters, who has defined empowerment as a situation. Now, here are two slides that I have put. You know, in this beautiful slide, it says that no, she'll definitely pursue her job after marriage. Monthly dowry is more sensible than one-time dowry. So there is this father who has educated the child, her daughter, and now they are negotiating for the marriage plan. So the father says that it is okay, let her pursue her job and we will pay you the dowry on a monthly basis. And there is this woman who is holding the placard of women education. Now there is another slide which I am presenting right now, which talks about the health condition, a very simple thing as cold. Now, what is a man's condition of cold? I know it might be an extrapolation of the condition, but it is a sarcasm. It is a joke on how the society has organized the health of the women. And what is the women's condition during the cold? So it is this McWhite's definition of empowerment who differentiates between the situation of empowerment where all these conditions are meant and an empowering situation where one or more situations are in place. What are we trying to talk here is that there is a situation where all the instruments which empower me fall in a line. And then there is a situation where few of the conditions of my empowerment are met. When I talk about the concept of access and control, it is here that the new definition of women empowerment lies. We do not just need access to the resources. We also need control to the resources. Now, what is the difference between access and control? Access gives me right to hold something for a short period of time, to use something, a resource which can be utilized, an opportunity which means something to me, but is guided by the rules and regulations. It is guided by the norms which governs the distribution and exchange through the institutional areas. I hope you all might have read about a Hindi story in class 8 or 7, which talks about two Dalit women who plan to go and steal some water from Thakur's well. It is titled Thakur Ka Kuwa. Now, the women are not allowed to go to the water during the daytime, and they have a controlled access to the water resource. That is the definition of resource I am talking about when I say access. You are not owing it. You are not owning it. You are being guided by the rules and the norms. For example, you have access to education as a woman, but do you have access to make the decisions based on the education that you have got into? And when we talk about control, it means the ability to choose or define how and for what purpose it will be used. So when I'm talking about the new meaning of women empowerment should be having control over the resources, whether they are tangible or intangible, whether they are material or non-material, whether it is about access to social life, whether it is about access to safe public life, whether it is about access to education, whether it is about access to a healthy old age pension plan. It is this kind of control to define how you are going to use it and for what purpose. But often there is an internalized oppression that we all women have just taken in. So when there is this debate between access and control, how are we going to define women empowerment? We are going to define women empowerment in terms of the control over the resources that are accessible to us. In case we have resources, how are we going to utilize it for our betterment and for the betterment of the society, for the betterment of the people around us? Now, this aspect of personal empowerment, where an individual is more important in the society, talks about the ways in which we can work upon nurturing our self-esteem, our autonomy, and our growth, and believing in ourselves that yes, for whatever limited resources we have now, we will develop a sense of confidence, a sense of capacity, and we will undo the effects of internalized oppression. When I talk about internalized oppression, I am reflecting on how we talk about the problem. For example, you go out of the house, you go to your workplace and something bad happens. What do you say? Oh, meri kismat hi kharab thi. This is all because of fate. You know, I was meant for it. It is wrong with my fate that I was born in the wrong gender. It was better to be a man. Many a times we say this. So it is about breaking from these shackles of believing that you are born in a wrong gender. It is about believing in the fact that, yes, you are confident enough and you have capacity enough when you have the capacity to be the creator of the society by procreating and by reproducing. Your productive forces, your productive equivalence should not be undermined because of your reproductive force. Second is by the close relationships that we have, where the empowerment is about developing the ability to negotiate. And I have the background picture is of a family where both husband and wife are cooking. There is son and daughter in the kitchen, and also there is father or maybe the father-in-law in the kitchen. So you have the ability to influence the nature of relationship and the decisions which are made within it. You have the ability to negotiate, explain your point. Do not shy away by believing that koi nahi sunne wala. There is nobody to listen to it. Or people will shut you off. They'll say that, oh, what are you talking about? It is rubbish. And then there is third, which talks about the collective empowerment, where the women, where the individuals are working together to achieve a more extensive impact, an impact where the involvement of the political structure is required, where cooperation is required, and it is not competition. Patriarchy also works through women. And as long as the women are played by patriarchy, the women are broken into different groups by patriarchy, and then there will be not a single unified voice about the conditions of the women. Our condition will prevail. We'll continue celebrating the Women's Day with new topics, with new agendas, which are prescriptive in nature, just like the doctor who treats the illness. So what we need is to stand with one another as folk, as community, have faith in one another and boost each other's morale. Even if it is someone traveling in a metro, a woman who is selling flowers in the temple premises, a woman who is suffocated in the marital relationship and is trying to escape it, do not naturalize it by saying that, sweet, this is the system and you have to give in to it. No, you do not have to give in to it. You have to understand each other's problem and you have to believe into collective consciousness, a conscience, whether it is good or bad as defined by the patriarchal structure, we have to have an empathetic understanding towards our social position. So the women empowerment should be like the process by which women organizations or the group who are powerless become aware of the power dynamics at work in their life context. Today, whosoever you are, you should realize that where are you coming from? What is your cultural background? And what kind of social barriers are you facing in your everyday life? Because when you address this, you will be able to address the problem which n number of women in the world are facing. Second, to develop the skills and capacity for gaining some reasonable control over your life. So it is about accessing the resources. It is about addressing the micro struggles, the macro dynamics of household, of community, of nation, and of the globe. When I am talking about developing these skills, I am talking about how every woman needs to undergo this capacity building program and realize her complete potential in whatsoever she believes in. If she believes in being a good housewife, she should not be burdened by the fact that it is her fate. She should have control over herself, over the domains of her private life. The third is about exercising this control without infringing upon the rights of the others. Often we see that in the name of women empowerment, in the name of gender equality, there is this radicalization that it has been an era of men. Now it should be the era of women. But femininity does not talk about it. Feminism does not talk about it. The Gaia philosophy does not talk about it. We talk about a world which is for all, the resources which are accessible by all. So when I'm talking about exercising our control, I'm talking about the control which we have about over the resources which are available to all. And it is our duty, it is our task as women to make these resources available to whosoever is excluded from it, to whatever gender he or she or Z belongs to. And then comes the last point where I'm talking about the support, to support the empowerment of others in the community. And this is the kind of definition that women empowerment should be, that Mac Whitner has given. It should be about the resources which are both material and social. We as women have a tendency to think that my mother used to do this when we were kids. She would take away those 100 rupees notes, 500 rupees notes, 1000 rupees notes. Even today she does it. And she will maintain her separate bank apart from the father's saving. And what will she utilize this money for? For small little things, petty little things, which were asked in our art and craft classes, which were asked in our SUPW classes. And my father would say that, what is this rubbish? Why is school teaching you all these things? This is not necessary. Or your school is asking for too much of money. But in spite of paying so much of fees, why are we paying for an SUPW material? But my mother would understand the fact that it would be an embarrassment for a child to go without the material which has been asked for the teacher. So it was not the money which was the resource here. It was this motherly instinct which worked upon it. And how will a woman be empowered here? How will my mother be empowered here? By his husband, by her husband. When her husband would have realized that the money which is being taken away from his wallet is important for his wife to give her a faith and belief that she has access to resources. See, she is making essential decisions which are going to change the fate of her children. The resources that are not given to us, that are denied to us, from water, household, job, property, education, information, political representation, fun, love, friends, and the social capital have to be controlled, but not by establishing a hegemony over it, but by sharing it with people who are around us. By reinforcing the concept of empowerment, which is still being defined by men in our society. We do not need the reduction of the term empowerment at the terms of the economic strength that will be instilled in us, at the terms of the political structure that give us the power. Why can't women empowerment mean giving access and equal opportunity to women in all social, public, and private domain? Giving opportunity to women at the cross-cutting edges which define this is meant for men and this is meant for women. The 21st century women have redefined what it means to be what it means being an empowered woman. But it is not just 21st century women who have redefined it. When you talk about Jhansi ki Rani, Rani Lakshmibai, when you just imagine a situation where a woman travels thousands and thousands of kilometers and she comes to India, she comes to West Bengal, and she is given the Nobel Peace Prize, Mother Teresa. How many of our parents will allow us to travel distance far away from the home and do something noble for the society? The women like Vijayalakshmi Pandit, they became the political epistemologies of the society who redefined the political strength. They did not require 33% reservation to bring to the fact that women are capable in making political decisions. The women in the business sector, Mrs. Majumdar, when she does it by bringing into the fact that there is this chemistry and biomedicine which can be utilized for the societal good, she must have been empowered enough to realize the potential. So today in 21st century, when we are celebrating a day on 8th of March, when leadership and redefining leadership during COVID is the agenda and talk, when in Cairo in 1994, the definition of empowering women was coined and talked about, and when there is a parliamentary debate during budget where the section of amount in crores is given for women development, all of this will become meaningless if we today, after attaining education, do not care about the folks who are around us and are not able to realize the meaning of education. My dear students, you know, I always believe that either the girl child should be educated or she should be given primary education and then married off. There are two reasons to believe in it. Number one, the moment you attain education, the meaning of education is to put you into a position where you can ask questions, relevant questions about the existing order, and it should not be termed as being rebellious. It should not be termed as being an outcast. It should not be termed as being badmash. No, it should be termed as asking a rational question using your five senses. So this is what education gives the women. The education gives women the power to ask questions about the existing order. This is the primary definition of women empowerment. To ask questions about the existing order, to have faith in yourself. Now, the second thing is, when I say that she should be married off after attaining a primary education, is the moment you start asking questions, the society will be nervous to address those questions. What is the appropriate age for the woman to get married? How do we define that the woman should organize herself in public? What are the outfits that will define the chastity of the women? We have a sound body and mind to realize that what kind of appropriate clothing and external ornamentation one should put, but that should not define who I am. That should not characterize my very essence of being a woman. So as a woman, we should understand that it is our right, it is our birthright to be educated, to ask questions which have been falling into the traditionalist perspectives, which has been taught to us as lessons. And it is more problematic for a modern woman because she is juggling between the household domain and the domain of workplace. We do not need to be Durga. We do not need to be Kali. We do not need to be Sati to redefine our empowered status. We should every day push limits by joining hands together, by showing empathy towards our fellow beings and understanding the fact that even a single voice, the very monotone, if it is being raised, is meaningful. Had Phule not realized it, had many of the political leaders, had Gayatri Spivak, had Uma Chakravarti not realized what meaning would her voice make to the essentials of the everyday life of the woman, they would have never written it. And the onus is not just on women, it is on the society. Because even if they are not able to see any gain out of which is materialistic, the UNDP and all the other organizations have calculated it for the human mind, which is only able to see the gains in terms of profit, that see, if the women are empowered, if there is development of women in the society and there are opportunities for women in the society, you are going to be the economy which has trillions of boost. So with this, I'll end my lecture. And to all those women who have joined us and to all those men who have joined us, it is not about the binary opposition. It is about the togetherness. It is about seeing each other's strength. Yes, the biology has made us different. We are biologically different from each other. And our biological strengths are not equivalent to each other. But we both are in synchronization of each other. We are like yin and yang of the society. And the day the men realize that the women, if absent from the society, the species will come to an end, they would start acknowledging the fact that whosoever and whatsoever they are doing, the women have equal right to do it, equal access to do it for the better survival of the humankind. Thank you so much.
Thank you so much, Dr. Sweta, for giving us your precious time and delivering a very insightful and thought-provoking lecture. We have already received some questions. We will appreciate if you address two of those questions, since we are already running short of time. So I'm just reading out the questions. The first one is by Shulagna Ghosh. Ma'am, please share your opinion why even modern educated and so-called empowered women who are financially secured does not have that decision-making power and in most cases, the spirit to decide about their financial investment. Over to Dr. Sweta.
Thank you, ma'am. Ma'am, you have asked a very relevant question, and this is what I have been talking about when I'm talking about access and control over the resources. The patriarchal structure has been so normalized in our everyday life that even if we have access to the resources, we have the economic strength, we have, say, a monthly income coming to our salaried account, are we empowered enough to make the decision to buy a house of our own? And you know, there is this strange realization. I'll share it with all those 106 people who have joined us, that the day when I was getting married, I had a realization that I do not have a home. I don't know how many of the women have this realization. I had a realization that I do not have a home because I was born in a house. I am being sent out in a house. So where am I? I'm in between these two things. And when you talk about having economic access to resources, but not being able to take hold of it, take control of it, it is because the society has always questioned you that whether it is your right to spend the money that you are earning, whether it is your right to make the investments that you want, because it is the control of the household that is exercised on your income. And this is what I refer to when I say that a woman's body is always in public discourse. It is in public discourse because every single decision, howsoever timid, howsoever minute, howsoever small it might appear to, has to be backed up, supported by a popular opinion of the family. When I say that we do not need an institutionalized structure, but a systemic change, which should be coming from the family, and that will mean an empowered, that will give the status of an empowered woman to us. So I hope I'm making sense when I'm saying that the economic capacity does not define my strength. It is the capacity to have command over the economic resources that I have. And it will only happen when this patriarchal structure demolishes. And how will it demolish? By us asking the questions, by us believing that, yes, I have the right to do what I want with the resources I have, and not seeking an authoritative permission from the others. Thank you for this question. I hope I made sense.
Madam, I have a question. Thank you. First of all, thank you so much for your beautiful presentation. I just want to say that, don't you think, madam, that when women are more educated and women have economic independence as a result of their education, and they have legal literacy as well, they are more empowered, particularly in the 21st century, particularly in a family which is not a joint family, is a rather a nuclear family. In this context, I just remember a beautiful study made by two female researchers, Farzaneh Raudi Fahimi and Valentine M. Mogadam. They were studying the woman's status in the MENA countries, that is Middle East and North African countries. And they saw that there is a direct link between women's education and their empowerment, that is when they are getting economically independent as a result of their education. In their study, yes, report, they have found out five very interesting conclusions. The last one is very relevant here. It states that when women are more and more educated, they are more and more legally aware and literate. They know quite well what their rights are and what legal steps are to be taken when such rights are violated. So they get better treatment from the male members of their families. And this actually sets better examples for their children, particularly their female children. That is when daughters see that their mothers are widely respected by their grandfathers or fathers or uncles in the family, if it's a joint family, they emotionally feel more secure and much safer. And that itself leads to a better pattern of their political socialization for the children in the family, particularly the female children. So a woman's legal awareness through education, I'm repeating, economic independence through education, legal awareness through education, not only brings about their own empowerment, but perhaps the future empowerment of the next generation woman as well. Definitely the conditions women were facing in the 19th or 20th centuries are not being faced by them in the 21st century if they are members of a nuclear family, right? Do you agree with it?
I totally agree to it, ma'am. And in fact, I am thank you for bringing this point out. See, I'm talking about economic independence. And when it is combined with legal education, the women have a better stand to understand the problem that they are facing. I totally agree to the fact that women who is educated is economically independent and has also a knowledge of legal strength that the women in the society have is better positioned than the one who is uneducated or has no economic capital or legal capital attached to her status. And you have very rightly pointed it out. For example, I'm going to support what you have said through an example. That, for example, in a normal nuclear household, there is this fight, there is this tussle, and the husband takes control and charges over the wife and says that I'm going to throw all your things out. Now, where will the woman go? A woman who is not economically sound is either dependent on the natal side, on the maternal side, or on the husband's family. So a problem as simple as this, as domestic violence, where our country is among the top rankers, is solved by the combination of these three. And yes, Honorable Principal Ma'am, you have pointed it really right. But along with this, there has also to be a consciousness. Because what happens with women, and most of the women who, in spite of being educated and being economically independent, do not have either legal education, and even if they have legal education, hamare samaj mein parampara pratishtha, it might sound like Amitabh Bachchan's dialogue of the movie, but it is right that parampara pratishtha anusashan and sanskar, ye aapke sanskar nahi hai, aap ek aurat ho, aap aisa kaise kar sakte ho. So you know how are women portrayed? The women are portrayed as the beings who either make the family or break the family. Ki ek aurat hi ghar ko swarg bana deti hai ya nark bana deti hai. The day we as women are able to come out of these traditionalist structures rooted in the chastity narrative of the women, it will uplift us, it will empower us. And yes, ma'am, you have pointed out really right that all these things together strengthen the women.
Thank you so much.
Thank you, ma'am. Thank you.
Amrita?
Yes, Amrita? Yes, yes. Am I audible now?
Yes, yes. You're
yes, audible. You okay, okay, okay. Thank you, Principal Madam. Thank you, Dr. Shweta. Dr. Shweta, you have another question. Shormishta Moitra has written, thank you, ma'am, for the useful and thought-provoking discussion. I was wondering if the Dalit women's customary rules and controlled access of the natural resources are specifically different from those of men. If we look at Munshi Premchand's Shodgati, so touchingly filmed by Satyajit Roy, it was the Dalit man who is maltreated by the upper caste Brahmin. Please throw some light.
Thank you for the question. And it is very appropriate for us, to the student who has brought this question, it is very appropriate for us to talk about Dalit women, Dalit men. You know, these are the subaltern positions that have been created because of the caste hierarchy. And my dear student, try to understand this. That yes, when we talk about Dalit men, they are subjugated and oppressed. But when we talk about Dalit women, they are in double trouble. They are in a problem which cannot be further problematized because it has no name to it. Why? Because here, your caste status and your gender status, they together combine and push you towards the periphery. Now, how Premchand has devised an instrumental means of showing the problems of the Dalit men is very right. That yes, the Dalit men in the man's world face the problem of being lesser men because they are Dalit. But what happens to the Dalit women is that they are subjugated by the caste oppression and also by the hegemony of the men in their very own caste. Now, when you talk about the customary rights and rules and regulations and duties, the very fact that the women have to organize themselves, the women have to become something as per the male standard is truth for all of us. Whether you are a Dalit, whether you are a black woman, whether you are a woman of no color, you are an albino or a yellow. Yellow is Chinese. You belong to South or North. But when we come to the problem of Dalit women, the problem is not just within the household, but it is also within the domestic and the public domain. Do you understand the fact that we, after years of independence, have seen that in certain parts of our country, the Dalit women are not allowed to cover their upper portion of the body? They would walk naked because that was then it was not in their rights to wear a blouse. So when a body is organized in certain way, where there is shame, where there is privilege, where there is status attached to certain organs, and then you are born Dalit, a community which is impure by blood, by shadow, and by everything. So a Dalit woman and a Dalit man, they both are in a subjugated position. But the women, because of being Dalit and the combination of being a woman, is further subjugated by the women and by the men on of his her community, and also by the society of the upper caste. Very, very little example, very small example of this is that, especially from the place where I come from and in Gujarat and in Maharashtra, I have seen that the people who are there for your household work, for your household chores, your domestic helpers, we also check out the caste that they come from, and mostly they are women. So why are Dalit women not taken as domestic workers, household workers? Also, when we talk, these are very, very big terminologies. When you talk about the thing that was written by Premchand is old enough to not qualify for the balance set of Indian society, because that is just one view, the myopic view of the problem. But when you go deeper into the picture, when your domestic worker is not having access to the kind of, and if you Uttar Pradesh and Bihar and Maharashtra and Gujarat are part of India, then try to understand the fact that the domestic household helpers who are women are not having access to my private toilet. This is the kind of discrimination. This is the kind of day-to-day discrimination. So when a Dalit is born woman, the problem for her is not just about being a woman, but also being a Dalit. But when Dalit is born a man, the problem that he faces is only of being a Dalit. I hope I have answered your question.
Thank you so much. Thank you very much, Dr. Shweta, for conducting such a wonderful session for all of us. We are really enlightened to hear you. Now I am requesting Professor Shongjukta Dash from the Department of English, Lady Brabourne College, to deliver the vote of thanks. Over to Professor Shongjukta Dash.
Shongjukta, please unmute yourself. Yes, can you hear me now? Yes, Shongjukta.
Yes. So it's now time for the vote of thanks. On behalf of the Women's Studies Center, Lady Brabourne College, that not only renews every 8th March its commitment to the cause of women, but works tirelessly through the year to work as an academic hub for research and writing on women, it is now time to express thanks. First of all, thanks to Madam Principal, Professor Shivli Sarkar, herself a well-known scholar of women's studies, whose support is behind today's webinar and all the programs of the Women's Studies Center. Our sincere thanks to Dr. Shweta of Mahatma Gandhi Central University for a talk whose minute nuance, immediacy, contemporary relevance, rich field experience has been an impactful contribution for this gathering on this day of 8th March. Thank you so much. Thanks to the conveners, my dear colleagues of the Women's Studies Center, Dr. Porna Ghosh and Dr. Mohua Roy, to colleague Ruby Pal, advisor to the center, and to all the members of the center for their committed work for this webinar. Thanks to all participants, colleagues across the nation, researchers, and our own students, whose participation has made this webinar a success. And last but not least of all, our thanks to Arvind Database, whose technical support has left us free to attend with full concentration the academic proceedings. Thank you all. Have a very good evening.
Thank you so much, ma'am. Thank you. And I would like to say that Honorable Principal ma'am addressed you as the. So this is what I'm talking about. You people are really living up to the fact that women are empowered in their everyday life. When the principal of the college calls the colleagues around her as Didi and the colleagues are calling each other as Didi, it means a lot to me. And I would especially like to thank Mahua ma'am, who just had met me.
Much,
yes. Yes. You.
My elders, right?
Yes, yes, ma'am. Yes, ma'am. Mahua ma'am, I really want to thank you because it was only once that you had met me on a virtual platform on a webinar during the COVID times on gender and you gave me this opportunity. And also thanks to all the bright students and teachers who joined me today and gave me this opportunity. Let's all make this life meaningful. Let's be happy and spend a good life helping each other. Thank you so much.
Looking forward to hearing you more, right?
Sure, ma'am.
Thank you so much.
Thank you. Thank you.